force of nature and a force for good in our community, and such a privilege to take a small part in honoring her and on the 90th anniversary of women's suffrage. Just amazing that it was only 90 years ago that women got the right to vote in this country. But when you look at Roxy's history, you realize that it was only a few years ago when women were able to do a number of things, and we're going to talk about some of those. I want to acknowledge that in this distinguished audience, Elaine, I see Mayor Thompson, and Elaine, Congresswoman Ileana West-Layton, and so many women of distinction who are great contributors to South Florida. I salute you all. And gentlemen, I sympathize and empathize with you as well. Thank you. I'm married to a squat woman too. On the coupon, I'll be quick. Let me read a remarkable letter that my friend and colleague Molly Turner wrote about her friend, Roxy Bolton. It was written in 1994. I wish so much that Molly were here to read it herself, but I'm proud to be able to read it for her. It's called Reflections on Our Journey Together. I remember my first encounter with Roxy Bolton. It was in 1969 when I was a reporter for WPLG Channel 10 in Miami. And it was then that I discovered I was a feminist too. Any encounter with Roxy was memorable, but this one struck home with me because she went to the Jordan Marsh department store to equalize the dining room. As was the custom then, there was a special dining area for men. They were quickly seated and quickly served while women, many of them working women such as I with short lunch hours, had to wait in line looking at empty seats in the men's section. Roxy got what she came for, her clinching argument: men and women sleep together, why can't they eat together? Roxy was not a working woman in the business sense. She stayed home and cared for her husband and three children, but she fought for working women. In 1970, my photographer and I went with her when she tackled the EEOC. Here was a federal agency with a mandate to promote equal opportunity in employment and eliminate discrimination in the workplace. Yet not only was it headed by a man, but all the investigators were men. After Roxy's visit, that changed. It was not only working women whom Roxy championed, she was very aware of the plight of abused women and the domestic violence that was, in effect, generally ignored by police and government. Roxy took the problem to heart and founded Women in Distress and secured a downtown shelter for abused women. I did a TV story on it when Roxy was scrounging for food for her tenants, as she called them. At that time, several women and three or four children who had no place else to go. Roxy was a one-woman organization running that home in addition to her own. It was a dramatic move to make the community wake up and take notice of the problem. Women in Distress was the first such shelter in the state. Another abuse that hardly anyone ever talked about, much less did anything about, was rape. Victims brave enough to report to police were often treated callously, and few in authority recognized or tried to deal with the trauma suffered by rape victims. But Roxy wasn't afraid to talk about it, and she did it publicly with a march against rape down Flagler Street. She buttonholed local officials at every opportunity and finally persuaded them that something had to be done. The result was the Rape Treatment Center at Jackson Memorial Hospital with its own doctor and staff. I remember being there with my camera when it was opened, and was honored to be the MC for the ceremony in 1993 when it was named for Roxy Bolton. When I think of how determined and inventive and dramatic Roxy was when she was out to right a wrong, I remember her visit to the president of the University of Miami, Dr. Henry King Stanford, in 1975. He had been avoiding her for some time. She alerted me that she was going over with an appointment, and I knew it would be a lively visit, so I went with my photographer. When we arrived, there was Roxy in the waiting room with a bedroll and a picnic hamper. prepared to spend the night or however long it took to see him. Needless to say, she did see him and laid out her argument for more women as department heads and equal salaries for men and women doing the same jobs. ROXCY was not a woman of her time. She created her time. She blazed the trail, put the spotlight on women, showcased their problems, and encouraged other women to take action and expand the fight for equal rights. She is a remarkable woman, a formidable adversary, a persistent advocate, a woman of courage and conviction who is not afraid to go it alone if need be, and she is a loyal and staunch friend. Florida is a much better place for women and men because ROXCY BOLTON widened the gate to equality. Molly.